Welcome to the second lecture of module 2, which is on manipulation of STL files. In this lecture, we shall discuss about the orientation of STL files, how can we rotate or translate these STL files. Also, we shall discuss about the support structures, the different type of support structures, and the zone where support structures are required. Also, we shall discuss about the optimal part orientation, and the optimal orientation of the part can be obtained by a cost model, a surface quality model, and a minimum support model. Now, let us discuss first about the rotation of STL files. If you have a point in the Cartesian coordinate system x, y, and z in 3D, and I want to rotate this object about x-axis. So, I am going to look at from this view and going to rotate this point about x-axis. So, a view from this end, if the observer is standing here, can be seen and it will look something like this. This will be your y-axis and this is your z-axis. Now, assume that this distance is L. And the projection of this point on the y-axis will be y1. The projection of this point on z-axis will be z1. And assume that this line is making an angle alpha from y-axis. Therefore, the distance y1 will be equals to L cos alpha and the distance z1 will be equals to L sin alpha. These are nothing but the projection of this distance on y-axis and z-axis. Now, if the point rotates by an angle theta x about the x-axis, in that case, this point will move to this red color point and this angle will be theta x. The new projection of this point on the y-axis and on the z-axis will be y2 and z2. Now let us write z2. z2 will be equals to then the length L. This length will remain same because I am only rotating it. So z2 will be equals to length L into sine theta plus alpha. Theta plus alpha. Let us expand this term and hence we will get z2 equals to L sin theta cos alpha plus L sin alpha cos theta. Also, we know that L cos alpha is nothing but y1. So, let us replace L cos alpha by y1. Hence, we have y1 sin theta here. Also, I can replace L sin alpha by z1. And hence, this particular term is now z1 cos theta. So, z2 is equals to y1 sin theta plus z1 cos theta. In a very similar fashion, I can write the projection of this point now on y2, that is y2, and y2 will be equals to L cos theta plus alpha, angle from here to here. Now, let us expand this term. And you will get y2 equals to L cos theta cos alpha minus L sin theta sin alpha. We have already seen L cos alpha will be equals to nothing but y1. And hence, this term is replaced by y1 here. And also, L sin alpha will be equals to nothing but z1 from this equation. Hence, y2 is equals to y1 cos theta minus z1 sin theta. Now let us write the coordinates of this new point x2, y2 and z2 in terms of x1, y1 and z1. So x2 will be equals to nothing but x1 because I am rotating about x-axis. So x2 will be equals to 1 x1 plus 0 y1 plus 0 z1. Also, we have just derived this equation, which it states that y2 equals to 0 x1, there is no x1 component here, plus y1 cos theta minus z1 sin theta. Also, z2 equals to 0 x1 plus sin theta y1 and cos theta z1. I can write this system of equation in the matrix form like this, and hence the new coordinate of the point, those are x2, y2 and z2 on the left side, can be written as a coefficient matrix multiplied by the coordinate which were earlier x1, y1, z1. This coefficient matrix is called as nothing but rotation matrix, and this is particularly here when rotation is about x-axis. This matrix is 1, 0, 0, 0 cos theta minus sin theta, 0 sin theta cos theta. In a similar fashion, if this point rotates about y-axis, then the rotation matrix will be this. You can easily derive it now. And also, if this point rotates about z-axis, the rotation matrix will be this. Now, you have all the rotation matrix. It is very important to note one point here, that the sequence of rotation is also matter. So, for example, if you are rotating about x-axis first, then about y-axis and then about z-axis, or you are rotating about y-axis, then z-axis, then about x-axis, the results will be different. So, basically, if I am just writing it, x2, y2, z2 equals to this sequence first. So, first rotation about x, second rotation about y, and third rotation about z. It will be written as r theta z into r theta y, x into x1, y1, z1. It is only when this sequence is followed. If the sequence is something else, then I need to write that sequence. So, for example, this is first, this is second, this is third, then r theta x dot r theta z, r theta y, and x1, y1, z1. So, this is how you can rotate any point in the Cartesian coordinate system. And we know that the triangles of the STL file are consisted of nothing but the three points only. So, let us extend the same analogy here. The coordinates of the rotated point can be given by this equation, where PIKX, PIKY, PIKZ are the coordinates of kth vertex. There are three vertex in a triangle. So, these are the coordinate of kth vertex of ith triangle, as there are number of triangles, I am talking about ith triangle. The I can vary from 1 to 2 to 3 to n, where n is the number of triangles to define, to represent the solid. In the similar fashion, the normal of the triangle can also be rotated. The normal of the triangle can be rotated, and the equation for that is written here. This is the new normal and this is the old normal multiplied by the rotation matrix, whether about x-axis, y-axis or z-axis, any one of them, where nix, niy, niz are the coordinates of outward normal of the ith facet or ith triangle. In a similar fashion, you can do the translation also. As the triangles of the STL file are consisted of nothing but three points, the whole thing will move. We need to just add the vector corresponding to the translate. If this triangle is moving like this in any direction, and it moves x, y and z in the different components, then the new points will be nothing but represented by this equation. Where, as I have already mentioned, PIKX, PIKY, PIKZ are the coordinates of the kth vertex of the ith triangle, where n is the number of triangles. In a similar fashion, the normal will not change now because you are just rotate, just moving. In a similar fashion, the normal will not change now because you are moving the whole thing, and hence contact normal will is not going to be changed. You can see that example. If this is my object and this is the contact normal of a facet, now you just translate it. The normal direction is not going to change. You go in any direction, the normal will always in this direction. And as it's a unit vector, definitely it is not going to change. But if I am rotating, you see that if I am rotating, then the contact normal will also change. Now let us see a small MATLAB code which I have written to read the STL file and to manipulate it. Here I have created a function which is known as import STL, and it imports the STL file in the ASCII format. You now also know each and every line which is written in the ASCII format, and appropriately you can just read the STL file. It is a very easy task. The file which I am going to import is known as cubea.stl. It is a cube which we have created in the last lecture. And if I will not rotate this STL file, it should look something like this. So this is your cube. It is consisted of the 12 triangles, 2 on each face of the cube. How it is reading? I am storing the data in this format. First vector is P. I am storing the data in this manner. This first matrix is P. The P matrix stores the X, Y, and Z coordinate of each and every vertex. Also, it stores only the unique vertices. Those are shared with multiple triangles. Later on, appropriately, the topology is defined. This avoids the repetition of the multiple points in storing, and hence your code can really work very fast. Then this vector T, which defines in this triangle which particular vertex is assigned, and then the normal of the triangle. So for example, I am representing this STL file through this code. This particular vertex, it is shared by this triangle, this triangle, this triangle, and this triangle. Therefore, I am storing this vertex only once. So this vertex is common, and hence I am just telling that how these triangles are formed. In this way, you can save really a lot of redundancy in the STL file. So all these points, those are here, I want to rotate. So it is very simple. I'll just define a rotation matrix. For example, I want to rotate this cube by 45 degree angle about x axis. So this theta x I have defined as 45, and the rotation matrix which we have just derived is written here. Now if I run this code, you will see that the cube has been tilted by 45 degree in counterclockwise manner about x axis, and this is how it looks like now. You can even rotate it about y axis as well. Let me just show you. If you rotate it about y axis, how does it look like? Now I am changing the parameters. There is no rotation about x axis, only there will be rotation about y axis, and that is 45 degree about y axis. And hence your STL file will look something like this. So it is very easy. Now only thing I am doing, I am just multiplying. You see that here in this loop, I am just multiplying the P with rotation matrix, means the all the vertices of the STL file with rotation matrix, and hence replacing the new vertex by this multiplication. If I want to rotate about y axis, the same thing is done here. You can also translate your object. For translation, I have defined a vector here T, and if I want to move this particular object by 100 mm, and don't want to do any rotation. So let me remove the rotation from here and run the code. You have seen the whole cube has moved. The cube looks like cuboid because the axes are not of same size. That is why it looks like a cuboid, but it is still a cube. But it has moved now. You see this particular point, the first point of this is not 0, 0, 0. It is 100, 0, 0. And the last point is, of course, 200, 0, 0. Also, we can multiply the rotation matrix with the facet normal also. Like written here, T norm equals to T norm into rotation matrix Rx. If it is rotating about Ry, means about the y axis, then it is multiplied by y axis. And hence, you can multiply and rotate the normals as well. Now, let us discuss about the support structure. The support structure is mainly required while creating the overhanging features in the STL files. In some additive manufacturing processes, the explicit support structures are not required, such as in the case of binder jetting and powder bed fusion, particularly sintering, the remaining loose powder act as a support material and later on can be removed also easily. However, in some additive manufacturing processes like FDM, DED, material jetting, the support structure need to be created in during the pre-processing of the CAD model. And later on in the post-processing, the support material also has to be removed by some means. An example of the support structure is shown here. This particular part, when it is built in this direction, this is the build direction, this portion is overhang portion. Means here the support will be required to create this part. Otherwise, this particular portion when we are creating may fall down. So these are the support for that. If I change the orientation of this object, you can see the support is required only for this zone. And if I further rotate this object, you can see that no support is required at all. You have already seen how to rotate an STL file. So we need to sometimes rotate the STL file in such a way that we can eliminate the support structure at all. And it is quite possible in some cases. The support structure is basically a sacrificial material added to support the overhanging features. There are other types of sacrificial materials also used in additive manufacturing, and those will be discussed later. Now, for a given STL file and build direction, the support structure can be easily calculated based on the facet normal of the triangle of STL file. If you see this particular triangle here, this is the build direction. Assume that plus Z is the build direction. You are building the object in the plus Z direction. Then the triangle, those are having normal pointing upward, will not really require the support material. But the triangle, those are having the facet normal downward, may require support material. Again, I said may require. We'll discuss about this word. Why I am saying that it is not always required. So if you are building the part in plus Z direction, like I said, let us consider the three different cases. Here the facet normal is upward. Therefore, definitely no support will be required for this particular case. In this case, facet normal is downward. And in this case, facet normal is again downward, but the angle theta is much larger than this one. Okay, so this theta is much larger. Therefore, in this case, support will be required, and in this case, support may not be required. Let us see when support is really required. Each additive manufacturing process deals with different type of materials, and different type of materials can sustain some overhang. Beyond a certain limit, the droplets or the molten material may fall down. Let us consider a case where it is required to build this particular wall. And it is having a certain amount of overhang. The facet normal everywhere which is same is downward like this. In this, if the layer thickness is capital T, the overhang is D. Overhang is nothing but this distance from here to here. Material which is not supported anywhere, while this material is supported on the pre-build layer. If I reduce the thickness of the layer, of course you can see for the same case, the overhang amount will reduce to small d and layer thickness will also reduce to small t. In that case, let us now consider that this is the face which we want to build and this is the contact normal, which is having an angle theta from the build direction, that is plus z. You are building in plus z direction. This angle is from here to here. Now, if this angle is theta, let me consider this particular triangle. Of course, we know that this angle will be nothing but pi minus theta. If this angle is pi minus theta, then of course in this triangle, this angle will be pi minus theta. Now you can use simply this right triangle, tan pi minus theta equals to T by D. Hence theta equals to pi minus tan inverse T by D. Therefore, if the angle alpha between the build direction K and the triangle normal N is greater than theta, the support will be definitely required. Meaning to say, if this angle, for example, this wall is tilted like this, for example, in that case, your contact normal will be this, or the facet normal will be this, and this will be the angle greater than theta. Hence, you need support mechanism. Let us find out what will be that angle first of all. So, this angle alpha, assume, will be equals to cos inverse, the dot product between the contact normal and the build direction, which is z direction here. That is why K is written here. Hence, alpha will be equals to cos inverse, the z component of the contact normal. Where, of course, nxi, nyi, nzi are the coordinates of the outward normal of the ith facet. Now let us solve a problem to find out the critical value of this alpha. It is given that in an additive manufacturing process, the maximum possible layer overhang can be of 1 mm. So the overhang which was unsupported by anything is 1 mm. So D is 1 mm. The build direction is plus z. We are building in this direction, that is plus z direction. The minimum possible layer thickness is root 3. That means the minimum possible layer thickness root 3 is given to you. Find out the critical value of z component of the facet normal of the triangles of an STL file. Beyond that, the support will be required. So let us first find out the theta. Theta will be equals to 180 minus tan inverse. It is given to you that T is nothing but root 3 and D is nothing but 1. And hence, this will be nothing but 60 degree. And hence, theta will be equals to 120 degree. That means, if this is the build direction and this is the facet normal, this angle is 120 degree. If this angle is beyond 120 degree, for example, for the lines like this, the contact normal will be this, hence this angle is beyond 120 degree, the support will be required. For no support, alpha should be less than theta, means this angle alpha should be less than theta. For the critical cases, alpha should be equals to theta, of course. And hence, cos inverse, the z component of the normal will be equals to 120, and hence, the z component of the normal is minus 0.5 Hence, if support is required, this particular component will be less than minus 0.5. If it will be less than 0.5, this angle will be beyond 120 degree and hence support may be required. You can very easily identify these triangles in the code which you have written in MATLAB. For example, this particular SQL file, if I say that, if I apply the same rule which we discussed in the last problem, that the facet normal, those are having angle greater than 120 degree with the plus z direction, which is the build direction, are highlighted here in yellow color and will require the support material. So this is the component, and if I tilt it, I just rotate it just to view, you see that these yellow triangles, they are having the contact normal which is greater than 120 degree. These particular triangles of course are going to have just vertical downward, and hence they are having 180 degree angle, and definitely it is greater than 120 degree. So support is required. For these blue triangles, support may not be required. For example, this particular triangle is having upward normal. It's not requiring any support material. This particular triangle is having 90 degree angle from the Z axis. Hence, it also doesn't require the support material. Till 120, it can support, but beyond that, it will not support. Let us see the same thing if we apply in our MATLAB code. So here I am going to give different color to the normals. This T normal is the vector which is storing all the normals and corresponding triangles. If this value is less than 0.5, which we just calculated, let us assume if it is less than minus 0.5, the Z component, the third component, if you see that 3 is written here, the third component of the contact normal, if it is less than minus 0.5, the color will be this, which is written 1, 1, 1 here. And if not, then the color will be something else. I am also counting these triangles. And I will show you, if I rotate the object, these numbers may change. So, let us consider the cube case first. And I am not going to rotate it or translate it in the beginning. In that case, if you see, these bottom two triangles are going to have 180 degree angle with the build direction. Therefore, these two triangles will require the support material. In a similar fashion, now rotate it by some angle. Let us rotate it by 45 degree about the x-axis. And you can see these triangles will require the support. And also, these two triangles will also require the support now, because they are now actually making an angle of 135 degree now from the build direction, which is definitely greater than 120 degree. And hence, both the triangles are requiring the support. And therefore, all four triangles are requiring now the support. So, just by changing the orientation of the object, you can see that the support can be increased or decreased. Let us consider an example of a sphere now. I have a file in the folder which is named as sphere SKY format and find triangles, like this, and I am going to open this. It will take few seconds, and you can see that all these yellow triangles, those are visible here, will require the support now, and the blue triangles will not require the support. I can change its value if I change the threshold. If I say that this value, if it is less than minus 0.1, then the zone where I was getting the triangles will increase. So you can see that now the zone where I am getting the yellow triangles means the triangle those required the support has increased now. And if I make it like less than 0, all the triangles those are greater than 90 degree will require the support and the zone will be exactly at half of the sphere. So this is how you can easily identify the support material or the triangles corresponding to the need for support material easily in an STL file. So this is how all the CAM packages of additive manufacturing works. You can appropriately orient your object in such a way that you can minimize the support. However, there are three different ways of optimizing the orientation of the part. One is the cost model, another is minimization of the surface roughness model, and the last one is this very easy and straightforward minimization of the support structure model. Let us discuss now about support structure. If, for example, someone wants to build this part by additive manufacturing and this is the build direction, then in that case no support will be required for this particular part. However, if you change the orientation of the part, then you will realize that the support will be required for some of the features. Like if I tilt it like this, then you can see this particular part when we build, it will require some support. To give a support to this particular region, we need to provide some structure that is called as support structure. And later on, when the part got cured, the support can be removed and it can sustain. So this is the basic of support. So how do we identify the region where the support is required and where the support is not required? We have already discussed the facet, those are having downward facet normals usually require the support mechanism. Also, we have seen that there is a threshold beyond that value we really require the support mechanism. If we have identified the triangles which requires the support, now the question is how do we generate the support to support these triangles? So there are two ways of generating the support. First is called as support generation from the facets. The support from the facet is generated by considering the project area of the triangles on a plane which is perpendicular to the build direction. So for example, you are building in this direction and there is a triangle here. This particular line is perpendicular to a horizontal plane like this. Then we need to consider the projected area of this on the bottom and that will be the footprint of the support. This part will now get protruded till the facet. The question is now how do we find out the projection of a triangle on a plane? For example, a triangle is consisted of three points, point A, point B, and point C, and we are building in a direction which is not really vertical but any random direction, and the perpendicular of that surface is given by nx, ny, and nz. Now our objective will be to find out the projection of each three point on this plane which is perpendicular to the build direction. Now let us consider that first our point is A. It's having a coordinates x, y, and z, and this point is going to project it on this plane which is perpendicular to our build direction, and the projected point is A dash. Its coordinates are now x dash, y dash, and z dash. The equation of this plane can be given like this. This is nx x plus ny y plus nz z minus a equals to 0. Now let us try to find out the value of x dash, y dash, and z dash. So first of all, let us find out the equation of a line A dash that is passing through a point x, y, z and it is parallel to a vector. And the line is parallel to a vector which is nothing but the unit normal nx, ny, nz. Hence, I can write the equation of line in 3D, you already know that, like this: x minus x by nx, y minus y by ny, z minus z by nz equals to alpha. It is a constant. Now this line will also pass through the line AA dash will also pass through the point A dash, as point A dash lies on this line. Therefore, the point X dash, Y dash and Z dash should satisfy this equation. Now, let me put this value here and replacing X by X dash, Y by Y dash and capital Z by Z dash. And hence, you will have X dash minus X by NX, Y dash minus Y by NY, Z dash minus Z by NZ equals to alpha. Now, I am giving a number to this equation as equation number 1. Also, point A dash lies on the plane on which we are trying to get the projection. And the equation of this plane is given by this equation. Therefore, if I put this point A dash into this equation, it should satisfy it, because A dash is lying in this plane. Hence, the equation will now become NX X dash plus NY Y dash plus NZ Z dash minus A equals to 0. That is my equation number 2. Now, let us find out the value of this alpha by using these two equations. It is very easy. That we can do easily by replacing X dash in this equation, in equation number 2, from equation number 1. I can write X dash equals to alpha NX plus X, like here. Similarly, I can write NY equals to alpha NY plus Y, and Z dash equals to alpha NZ plus Z. And hence, this is my equation number 3. From this equation, I can easily find out now value of alpha, because that is the only unknown here. Once I know the value of alpha, I can put it into the equation number 1 and find out X dash, Y dash and Z dash. Now let us consider that if the build direction is in plus Z direction. In that case, if the build direction is plus Z, NX will be equals to 0, NY equals to 0 and NZ will be equals to 1. That means the unit vector in the direction of plus Z will be nothing but 0, 0, 1. We know that. And the base on which we are building the part is XY plane, which is nothing but here. Therefore, your A will be also 0 in the equation of plane. Now, let us put all these values in the equation which we have derived, equation number 3. And hence, your alpha will be equals to minus Z. Now, again, let us use equation number 2 and find out the X dash, Y dash and Z dash. It will be obviously X dash will be equals to X, because your NX is 0 and Y is 0 and NZ is 1. And now we have just seen alpha is equals to minus Z. Therefore, your X dash equals to X, Y dash equals to Y and Z dash equals to 0. However, we have considered a very simple case when the build direction is plus Z. In some cases, like when you deal with DED type of systems, the build direction may not be along the vertical axis. As the build direction may change, that is why we just derive a generic equation and consider now a specific case when the build direction is plus Z. So, you can easily see if you have three points P1, P2 and P3, their projection on the base can be obtained just by replacing Z by 0. And rest X will be X. So, for example, if P3 is X, Y, Z, then of course P3 dash will be nothing but X, Y, 0. In a similar fashion, P2 dash and P1 dash. But please remember that it is true only when the build direction is in plus Z direction and your base is aligned with XY plane. Now, let us try to find out the volume of the support which we are generating. If this is ith triangle and this volume which we are trying to find out is represented by VI, that is the volume of, that is the volume corresponding to the ith triangle support. Hence, the support, volume of the support for the entire object can be given by I equals to 1 summation for all the triangles, that is the number of triangles, VI equals to summation I equals to 1 to N AI into HI, where of course N is the total number of down facing facet of STL file, those required the support, all the down facing triangles may not require support. So only those down facing triangles, those required support, that is represented by N here. AI is the projected area of facet I onto the horizontal slicing plane, and HI is the average support height evaluated from the corresponding facet to either the platform or to the next intersecting facet, whichever is less. Now, what is the meaning of this? So, for example, if you are building an object maybe like this, in this direction, these are the facets, those are having downward normal, and also these are the facets, those are having downward normal, and assume that they all need support. In that case, this support generated for these triangles will be projected on the part itself, while for these triangles the required support will touch the base. Therefore, we have mentioned HI is the average support height evaluated from the corresponding facet to either the platform, if for example this one is going till the platform, or to the next intersecting facet, those are here, for this particular support, whichever is less. Let us now just look at some nomenclature for the support mechanism. This is our part. The green color one is the support everywhere, and this black color one is nothing but the substrate or base, or sometimes also called as platform. Here you can see the support is projected on the base because it is going till the base. But in this portion, the support is going up to the part. Therefore, it is called as support projected on part. In a similar fashion, here also the support is projected on the part. While there is a region which is having the downward facet normals, there is a region here which is having the downward facet normals, but in these cases the facet normal is not sufficiently downward, which required really the support. It is sometimes also called as self-supporting region, because this is an overhang but it doesn't really require the support. Now I'll show you one example of the support generated in a commercial package, and here you can see that these overhanging features require the support, and the support is projected on the part. So this particular support is projected on the part. While look at this support here in this zone, the support is projected till the platform or base. Hence, this is the support projected on the base. In a similar fashion, you can see these are the some supports, those are projected till the part only, and these are some supports projected on the platform. Now let us try to solve an example. The question is, the build direction of the object shown in this diagram is in plus z direction, and the support is required for the facet normals having angle greater than 120 degree from the build direction. Means if this is the build direction, this is the plus z build direction, and if there are facets, those are tilted like this and having the facet normal in this direction, and this angle I am talking about, this is theta. If this is greater than 120 degree, then only the support will be required. Determine the projected area of the support required for the given facets. Also, we have to ignore the base support, which is required to support the entire base. Second part of the question is, how many triangles you will examine for support calculation? Also highlight locations of these triangles. As by just looking at the drawing of the object, you can identify the zone where the support is really required and the zone where support is not really required. So of course, these are the critical zone 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Also, it is said that we have to ignore the base support. That means these facets are going to be directly in contact with the base. Hence, let us avoid or ignore these triangles because they are anyway going to support by the base. Now, these are the three zones or three reasons. So now these are the three reasons where we can see or examine the requirement of the support. Of course, this is the horizontal one, and this is the downward facet normal. This will require the support mechanism. While let us look at this slant edge, it is making an angle of 30 degree. That means the facet normals for this will be having 150 degree angle from the vertical, which is of course greater than the threshold given, that is 120 degree. However, if you look at this, which is this face, the facet normal for this will make an angle of 120 degree from the build direction, that is your plus Z direction. In that case, support may not be required for this particular zone. Hence, the support will be required for this zone and only for this zone. Let us have a look at the 3D CAD model of the same. Here you can see this triangle we are not considering because they are directly attached with the base. These two triangles we are ignoring because the facet normal of these two triangles are making 120 degree from the build direction. Now the remaining triangles which are of our interest, those requiring the support, are this triangle, and this triangle. So total four triangles are of our interest now. If I have the ASCII format of the STL file, then I can easily look into its code and I can identify the triangles those are having the facet normals making an angle of greater than 120 degree from the build direction easily. These triangles can be identified by looking at the Z component of the facet normal. If the Z component of the facet normal is lesser than 0.5, then of course the facet normal will require, or that particular facet will require, the support mechanism. So it can be seen here also, if NZI is less than cos alpha, support will be required. What is NZI? It is nothing but the Z component of the facet normal of ith triangle. Now if our threshold is 120 degree, then if this Z component of the facet normal is less than minus 0.5, the support will be required. As we have ASCII format in front of us, we have chosen those triangles, those are having the Z component less than minus 0.5. So there are only four such cases. There is one triangle which is having exactly equals to minus 0.5, but we have to ignore it because it is not coming beyond the threshold value given, that is this particular face. So two triangles were during along with this particular face. So we will not consider this. So only these four triangles will be considered, and we will find out the projected area only for these triangles. As the build direction is plus Z, it is very easy for us now to find out the projected points on the plane. These points will be nothing but X, Y and 0. We will just replace the Z component by 0. Therefore, everywhere wherever Z component is there, we will replace it by 0. This will give us nothing but the projection of this triangle on the base, which is perpendicular to the build direction, and build direction is plus Z. So all these terms are going to be 0. Therefore, you will have the four vertex. Those will look like this, 80, 0, 0. So let me draw that point correspondingly, 80, 0, 0. Then 50, minus 10. So 50, minus 10, assume it is here. And then 50, 0, 0. So this is the projected triangle. In a similar fashion, we can do for all the vertices. Now this is 80, minus 10. So this is 80, this is minus 10, 80, minus 10. Then 50, minus 10 and 80, 0. 80, 0 is here. That means this is the triangle. Similarly, the third triangle will be having three vertices, 50, 0, 0. So 50, 0, 0 here. Then 30, minus 10. So this is 30, minus 10 and 30, 0, 0. Therefore, the triangle will look something like this. The fourth triangle the projection of force triangle will be 50 comma minus 1. So this is 50 comma minus 1. Then 30 comma minus 10. So this is 30 comma minus 10 and 50 comma 0. So this is the projection of fourth triangle. You can easily find out the area of these triangles by using this formula. We know that. Or you can directly find out by using the half of base into height, because it is easy for these triangles to find out by using this formula also. Once you get it, for each triangle you can add the area for each and every triangle, and hence you will have the total projected area on the base. If it is required to find out the volume, then you can multiply the projected area, the summation of all the projected area, in that case we have four triangles, into the average height. This projected height can be calculated by the z component of the three vertices and by taking their averages. Now let us discuss about generation of support by the contours. In this method, first the contours are generated by slicing the entire object. Then these contours are used to generate the support structures. There are two popular methods of doing it. One is called as contentment and another is optimal method. The contentment method says the area to be supported is determined by projecting all the contours on the plane and then merged to get the external support. This big contour is then subtracted from the contours at each slice to determine the internal contours for support. So basically, if you have a CAD model like this, we do the slicing of the object and get the intersecting contours. How do we get the intersecting contours? We'll learn soon in the next lecture. But if you have those contours, can be utilized to generate the support. These are some slicing planes, and if we take the intersection between these planes and the object, you will get contours. So as per the contentment method, for example, to understand better this method, let us consider an example. For example, we want to build support structure for realizing this bone in this direction. So this is the build direction for this bone. Like it is said, first we will consider the intersection between the slicing plane and the bone. And the intersection between the slicing plane and the bone will give you nothing but the series of contours like this. Now the next step is project all these contours on the base plane, like you are seeing here. It is very easy to do because each contour will be consisted of some points, and these points will be having x, y and z coordinate. If I am projecting these points on a plane which is xy plane, then I need to just replace the z coordinate by 0, and hence all the contours will be projected like this. Then we need to use a marching algorithm to identify the outer contour. That is what you are seeing here. Then this particular contour, which is nothing but a bounding box. Now this big contour, which is nothing but the bounding area of this bone, is now projected upward like this. And each time a subtractive Boolean operation occurs between this big contour and these small contours. So for example, let me consider a particular case, maybe here. The big contour will look something like this, and there will be a small contour inside. It says that in this zone you need the main material, while here you need the support material. In a similar fashion, you can build it up to the top. However, it is not a very optimal method, because it can find out the support even those regions doesn't require the support. Therefore, another method came into picture, which is called as optimal method. Let us now discuss about the support generation from contours. In this, now we shall discuss the optimal method.
in this method, first the contours are generated by slicing the entire object. Then these contours are used to generate the support structures. So this is how a sliced object look like. So this is the object which we want to use and to generate the support structure for this particular object when it is built in this direction. This is the build direction. So these are the slicing planes, and we take the intersection between the plane and the object. As a result, we get the contours. If this is the nth slice and this is the n minus 1 slice, corresponding to that, the contours are shown here. This contour is corresponding to the nth slice, and this contour is corresponding to the n minus 1 slice. It can be observed very easily that after deposition of this slice, this region is going to be the overhanging region. While this portion here will be the supported region. By utilizing this analogy, now we shall discuss how we can proceed further to generate the support automatically. If these are some slices you are seeing here, these are some contours generated on different slices here. Assume that this is the nth slice, this is the n minus 1 slice, this is n minus 2 slice, this is n minus 3, n minus 4, n minus 5, n minus 6, and so on. The first step is in this processor to get the projection of nth slice on n minus 1 slice. As a result, what you will see if we consider the case of the projection of nth slice contour on the n minus 1 slice contour, you will see something like this. Now, it is obvious that the region which is unsupported can be calculated by subtracting the upper contour from the bottom contour. Here you can see this is the contour corresponding to nth layer and this is the contour corresponding to n minus 1th layer. Hence, this region will require the support. How do we obtain this region? It is nothing but subtracting n minus 1th contour from nth contour. And as a result, that blue portion is highlighted here separately. So this is the support. Now, if this is the support, we are going to deposit a merge of this nth minus 1 contour and nth contour in the n minus 1th layer, then only the nth layer will get support. That means this particular contour is what we will deposit. Of course, it will consist of two material, where this much will be approximately the support material and this much will be the main material. But as a whole, the material will be available in n minus 1 slice in this region. Now let us consider the n minus 2th layer and the projection of the material available on n minus 1th layer. And we have already seen this is what the material is available on n minus 1th layer. Therefore, now we will consider the projection of this green boundary in this particular diagram on the n minus 2th layer, and that is what is projected here. Now again, you can see that the projection of the n minus 1th layer contour on n minus 2 will give you the region which will require support, that is not basically supported by the contours available in n minus 2, and this is that region. The same is highlighted here. After subtracting the n minus 1th contour from n minus 1th material available contour, that is this one, and hence you got the area where you need the support. The projection of the n minus 1th layer contour on n minus 2th layer contour is also called as shade. So what you are seeing here are also called as shades. You can see one very interesting thing here. If this is the support required at n minus 1th layer, and this is the support required at n minus 2th layer, you can see easily that there will be a common portion available in n minus 1 and n minus 2. That common portion I can highlight here. Like this was already available or already required for n minus 1th layer. This portion is called as stale support or stale shade, and this one which just came up newly is called as fresh support. So there are now two types of support: stale support and fresh support. We will repeat the procedure and we will keep on calculating the regions for the support material, and you will find that this portion which keep on accumulating, that was everywhere common, will form a composite support kind of thing, and hence it may go up to even till the base, while this particular region is directly connected or directly attached with the main material. Hence one can even think of utilizing two different methods of generating support, which is directly connected with the base, which is the common contour, and the support which is directly connected with the main material. It is also called as interface support. So this is how you can generate the support for all the slices, and hence you can proceed for generating the optimal contours. And this is how you can generate the support for each slice, and hence you can generate the support for entire part. Now let us solve this problem. It says generate the support for the given object utilizing the optimal slicing contour method. Show the stale and fresh support. So for example, this is our nth slice, this is n minus 1, this is n minus 2, this is n minus 3, this is n minus 4, 5 and 6. It can be observed here, the contour which we will get by intersection of the object and nth slice will be assumed that it is something like this. Assume that it is something like this. Then the contour corresponding to n minus 1th layer will be definitely smaller than that, and hence assume that it is something like this. Further, it will keep on reducing. So let me just draw it approximately. And so on. Now our first objective will be to get the projection of the contours available on n slice on the n minus 1 slice. And hence, in this case, if I'll just draw the projection, it will look something like this. And I'm going to draw only the top view. This is the contour in n slice, and this is the contour in n minus 1 slice. It is obvious that the region which is unsupported is highlighted here. Hence, this much portion will require support. Now, let us take the intersection between this outer contour of this particular merge region, that is this one, and between the next slice, which is here, that is n minus 2. And hence, what you will see is something like this. Now, it is obvious this much region was already requiring the support. Hence, this region should be considered as a stale support region. And this region, which I am double hatching here, should be called as fresh support region. Now, this is the way you can proceed further to find out the stale and the fresh support region. Let me just show in this diagram itself the summary of the support. So, the region which is supported here will form a composite support structure, and that should be called as stale support because it is common for all. And the region which is here will be called as fresh support. One can easily observe the thing here that the fresh support is directly in contact with the part, while the stale support is not in contact with the part. Therefore, I can use a different method of generating this stale support, and I can use a different method for generating this fresh support. Why so? Because this stale support forms a very big lump area. Because this stale support forms a very big lump volume, while the fresh support is directly in connection with the part. Hence, this fresh support should be in such a way that while removing this support, the part should not get disturbed at the interface. So, it is a very popular method and very much popular, particularly for FDM. Now, let us discuss about the optimal orientation of the object. The orientation of the part during its fabrication can affect its quality and cost. Following are the most popular models for obtaining the optimal orientation of the part. First is called as cost minimization model. Second is called as support minimization model. And third is called as multi-objective model. The cost minimization model basically minimizes the overall cost which is required to build the part. The cost required to build an object, which is represented here by CT or total cost, is nothing but the summation of the pre-processing cost, C pre, plus the build cost, that includes the machine utilization cost for building the object, that is C build or cost for building. C mat, that is nothing but the material cost, which includes the cost corresponding to the main material as well as the cost corresponding to the support material. Then C post, that is the cost corresponding to the post processing of the object. For this cost model, we are assuming that the part is already available with us and no cost is required to create the model. Now let us discuss in detail about the cost involved in each and every component. So, the first one is C pre, that is the cost corresponding to the pre-processing. It involves the model deposition time, the support generation time, model slicing time, and tool path generation time, multiplied by the money involved for hiring the staff, that is nothing but the staff cost per hour, plus the computing facility cost per hour. These two costs per hour are added together and then multiplied by the computational cost. Next is, in the pre-processing requirement, is the time for setup, that is the machine setup time, and it is again multiplied by the cost for the staff, that is staff cost per hour, and the machine utilization cost. The machine utilization rate is represented like this: Rmax equals to M plus C by T, where M is the annual maintenance, that is approximately 15% of the total cost or the initial cost of the machine. C is the initial cost, T is the life of the machine. It is divided by, 365 by 15, where assuming that in the 365 days of an year, per day the machine is running for 15 hours. The next cost is cost required for building the part. It is nothing but the build time into the machine utilization cost. We have just seen that the machine utilization rate is given by M plus C by T divided by 365 by 15, where M is 15% of the initial cost, that is the annual maintenance, C is the initial cost of the machine, and T is the life of the machine. 365 by 15, again I am explaining, is required because we are assuming per day the machine is running for 15 hours in a year. Now, if this is the cost for build, please note that the time required to build the object varies for different processes. There are 7 processes we discussed for additive manufacturing. Light in the case of wet photopolymerization, when we use DLP, digital light processing, the entire layer is cured in a single go. Hence, the time is proportional to the height of the object in the case of DLP based wet photopolymerization. While in the case of FDM, let us assume the time is proportional to the volume of the object, because we are going to deposit each and every place of the part, and hence the time is proportional to the volume. That is why different additive manufacturing process, when we will discuss all 7 AM processes, require different build time. The next is the material cost. And of course, there are 2 types of material required. One is the main material, and next is the support material. Next is the post-processing cost. In the post-processing, of course, the time required for post-processing the object, like for finishing, for removing the support mechanism and all, into the staff rate, that is staff cost per hour, plus other miscellaneous cost required after building the part, such as utilization of a UV on for SLA parts, and also like hot isostatic pressing for the metallic parts. So these are all considered further in the miscellaneous cost. So if we have all these costs, we have to minimize the overall cost by orienting the part in such a way that the overall cost of the object can be reduced. So we have already seen now the meaning of each and every cost involved in the total cost. And the total cost is consisted of the pre-processing cost, the build cost, the material cost, and the post-processing cost. We have also seen the different parameters for each and every cost. Therefore, in the cost optimization model, we optimize this overall cost. Hence, the objective function looks something like this: minimization of the function CT. And hence, to achieve this, our variables are obviously the orientation of the part, that could be theta x, theta y, and theta z. Theta x, theta y, and theta z are the angular position of the object with respect to x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. Now let us discuss about the support minimization model. We know that the volume of the support can be calculated by this formula. We have already discussed about it. It says if n of the total number of down facing facet normals are available in STL file and those are requiring the support, then the total volume of the support will be equals to summation I equals to 1 to n and the volume of support required for each facet. We know that. How does it look like? If this is the triangle and we are building in z direction, it is obviously having a facet normal downward, and assume that it is beyond a threshold value, then we take the projection of this triangle on the xy plane, because xy plane is perpendicular to the build direction, and hence we got this. So this vi is nothing but the volume of this particular region, what you are seeing here.
it is obviously very easy to get because we have already discussed how to get the projected area. And if I multiply this projected area by the average height hi, then you can have the average volume of this particular region. How do we get hi? It is obvious. You have the z component corresponding to each vertex. You just take the average of these three to get the hi. Sometimes the triangle doesn't project down to the base, it may project to the part also. We have also seen such cases. In that case, the projection will not be on the base, it will be on the part. In a generalized manner, we can say that AI is the projected area of facet I onto the horizontal slicing plane, and HI is the average support height evaluated from the corresponding facet to either the platform or to the next intersecting facet, whichever is less. Here now, the objective function is minimization of the volume VE of the support which we are generating in the entire object. And of course, again, the variables are theta x, theta y, and theta z. Theta x is nothing but angular position of the object about the x-axis, y-axis is theta y, and about z-axis is theta z. We keep on changing these variables until we get the minimum value of the volume required for generating the support. However, the orientation problem sometimes considered as the multi-objective optimization problem. The optimal orientation of the object is a multi-objective problem with an appropriate weightage for each of the individual criteria. These criteria could be, or you can even add further for particular AM. But some generalized criteria I am highlighting here. Those are: maximize the number of perpendicular surfaces, maximize the number of top facing horizontal surfaces, maximize the number of hole with their accesses in the build direction, maximize the number of curved cross sections drawn in the horizontal plane, maximize the area of the base surface, and minimize the number of sloped surface, and minimize the number of trapped volume. Now let us discuss about each and every of these criteria in slight details. The first one is maximize the number of perpendicular surfaces. So let us consider a case. For example, we want to build this particular cube. Then of course, these surfaces, surface 1, surface 2, and the surface on the back side 3, and this surface 4, they are perpendicular to the base. What is the benefit if the surface is perpendicular to the base? Because when you are building the part in a layer by layer fashion and the part is perpendicular to the base, in that way your surface roughness will be best if you build the surfaces keeping perpendicular to the base. So you just look at this example. In that case, the RA value you will achieve for this particular face or surface will be best. If I tilt it, for example, in that case, your generation of support will be something like this, because this surface is not perpendicular to base, right? So you can see that the surfaces, those are perpendicular to the base, used to have the better surface finish compared to the surfaces those are not perpendicular to the base. Hence, this particular cube should be built in this direction, in this orientation only, instead of tilting it about an axis. Of course, if you tilt it by 90 degree, then again, the number of surfaces perpendicular to the base will remain same, and hence it will not get affected. But if you tilt it by, for example, 45 degree, then in that case, none of the surface will be perpendicular to the base. So we need to keep this in mind, this criteria, and always try to keep maximum number of surfaces perpendicular to the base. Then next is maximize the number of up facing horizontal surfaces. So
this particular example can depict this particular criteria. Here, these are the horizontal surfaces. As many as surfaces, up facing surfaces, means their contact normal or facet normal is upward like this. We should have as much as possible triangles in such a orientation that their facet normal is upward along the build direction. Next criteria is the maximize the number of holes with their axis in the build direction. Now, for example, you have a cylindrical object like this and it is having a hole here. This is the axis of the hole. If the axis of this hole is along the direction of build, that is plus Z, then in that case there will be no issues and you can create the hole nicely. But if you are having a cylinder which is tilted like this, the same example I am considering, and in that case your hole is like this, means its axis is not along the build direction, you are building it like this. In that case, what will happen? You may require some support here, and removal of the support in the hole is a very difficult task. That's why we should try to keep as many as hole axes parallel to the build direction. This particular criteria says maximize the number of curved cross section drawn in the horizontal plane. So if you are getting a cross section which is curved like this, or any random curve, this type of curve should be more in the horizontal plane. If you are getting this cross section and you are building it in, for example, another direction, the issues may be there. I'll just give you a very simple example. For example, you have this object and it is extruded just like this. On the bottom side also, it has the same profile. Now, if I keep this curved cross section in the horizontal plane, that orientation will be best to build it. If I tilt it, in that case the cross section will be tilted also, and hence your part which you are building may not have very good surface roughness at the surface or at the boundary. Therefore, it is desirable to maximize the number of curved cross section drawn in horizontal plane. Maximize the area of the base surface. Now, for example, it is asked to build this particular part, then it is desirable that the base surface area should be higher. Right now, this is the base surface area, A1, this is A2. And it is obvious from here that A1 is less than A2. While it is desirable that your base area should be maximum. Why so? Because during the build, it is desirable that the entire component is rigidly attached with the base. Otherwise, the part may topple or it may disturb and move here and there, and hence your deposition may get disturbed. In other words, the CG of the part you are building should lie inside the component. It should not lie outside the component, because if that is happening, in that case also the part may get toppled when you will do some other operations over it. The next is minimize the number of sloped surface. So if there are slope surfaces in the object, then we should try to minimize the slope surfaces in such a way that your support will be, of course, less. This particular criteria is directly related to the support minimization criteria. Next is minimize the number of trap volumes. So, for example, if you are building a part like this and you are building it by SLA, this particular criteria is most of the time valid for SLA process. In that case, when you are building it, the liquid material will be trapped here. This type of trapped volume creates some issue during the build, and particularly when we spread a new layer of material. This phenomena we shall discuss in detail when we'll discuss about the SLA process. So such volumes should be minimized. Of course, this volume will not get trapped if you just change its orientation of the part. But on the other hand, the support mechanism or the number of sloped surfaces will get increased. So we have to make a compromise appropriately. Therefore, whenever there is a multi-objective model, we should give particular weightage to each and every criteria, and hence then we should optimize this orientation problem appropriately to get the desired results. So for example, there are 7 weightages given to them, and the weightages may vary depending on the additive manufacturing process you are using. So with this, thank you very much.